Well, I'm joined now by Ian Davidson, who chairs the Scottish Affairs Select Committee. Thank you for coming in, Mr. Davidson. It is a matter of fact, legally, that there is no knockdown argument on either side, and you could lose this if you go to court.
No, I don't think that is the case, actually. The overwhelming balance of legal opinion that we received, and I must admit I'm not a lawyer, was that it's absolutely clear that the responsibility for the Constitution, the relationship between Scotland and England, lies with Westminster. And that was quite specifically in the Scotland Act that was agreed by the Scottish people in the referendum in 97. Now, I do understand, of course, that if you pay lawyers enough, they will argue a contrary case. No lawyer that we have come across at all says that the Scottish government has got the power to conduct a referendum on their own. The most that they will say is that it's an arguable case, as your speaker there said, which means that it would end up being disputed in court.
Right. That is quite an astonishing proposition to say that the lawyers who are engaging in this, who give the alternative viewpoint, are doing it because if you pay a lawyer enough, they'll say anything. But two of the names,
Your audience would agree that if you hire a lawyer to fight a case for you, he will fight that case. That's the point of paying lawyers.
Well, the point of the law in all of this is there isn't case law in this. We don't know. You have eminent lawyers. Neil Walker at Edinburgh, Aileen McCarg at Strathclyde, you know, both saying, actually, this could go the other way because we don't have the case law in this.
None of them say that it wouldn't end up in court if the Scottish government tried it to do it on its own. That's the point.
Well, no, it would end up in court if someone triggered that action, obviously, but that's not the point. The point is whether you would win or lose in court.
Well, no, it's not. Because the point is, we want to have a speedy referendum. My side want to get this resolved. We want to have a referendum because we think we're going to win, quite frankly.
Okay.
And we believe that having an agreement between Westminster and Scotland through a Section 30 notice where there is no dispute about the legality is by far the best way forward.
Well,
what we're opposed to is unilateralism.
If you want that, then legally, there is nothing to stop you tomorrow putting in process the Section 30 permission. There is absolutely nothing
to stop you doing that. I mean,
will you attach conditions to it?
Well, of course.
But why,
I mean,
you must here separate out the law, which you could do that. You could get the Section 30 order through at any point, immediately.
Yes,
or you could attach conditions, which then, that political decision to attach conditions is where the problem lies legally. So what you're doing is, instead of going ahead with a legal solution, you attach conditions to it, which is a political decision.
I understand that. I mean, I understand that Newsnight Scotland's position is that the power should be given to the Scottish Parliament and the SNP should do as they wish. We understand that.
That is a ludicrous proposition to say.
Well, I don't believe
it. I am asking you a perfectly reasonable question that I am entitled to answer.
And I've answered it partly in
you're
the way
suggesting
I wanted.
I've predicated my question on a preconception about what's an approach.
Well, of course. I mean, that's a general political view, that Newsnight Scotland is biased in favour of the Scottish Parliament handling all these powers themselves. Now, our position is not that. You see, our position is that we believe that Westminster have been given powers to deal with this matter by the Scottish people in the referendum. That's where our legitimacy comes from. Legitimacy comes from the Scottish people in the referendum. We have therefore got a responsibility to decide how these matters should be dealt with. We have the opportunity, if we wish, simply to hand over powers to the Scottish Parliament, but we choose not to do so. And what we are saying in the committee is that the Scottish MPs and the Scottish Affairs Committee should have the responsibility for reviewing and supervising and assessing any Section 30 notice that is proposed.
Before we continue, it perhaps might be appropriate at this stage if you would like to apologise to me for suggesting that I have come into this interview in any way biased against your argument and for one political party or the other. Nobody in this programme works in that way, and it is offensive that you should suggest that.
Well, I have to say I don't believe that. I've already complained, as has the Labour Party on a number of occasions, about the way in which Newsnight Scotland behaves, and I think you are clearly biased and have been for a long time against the unionist parties, and if that causes you concern, then I'm afraid you've just got to recognise that politics is about people exchanging views, and you're not above the fray, and if you want to stand for election, do so. otherwise try and be more neutral.
Well, I absolutely reject what you've said there, and I think there's plenty of evidence to refute that, but let's move on because we don't have a lot of time. Are you suggesting you derive your mandate from the 97 referendum?
Yes, I think...
Okay, let's then say your argument is that people going into the 97 referendum had in their mind whether a future referendum conducted by the Holyrood Parliament would be intra or ultra vires, and they satisfied themselves to the fact that it would not be. I mean, how then can that referendum possibly relate to...
Not at all. I mean,
mandate.
But you've got to remember that in 97... there was a whole number of things being proposed, one of which was the establishment of the Scottish Parliament, one of which was the ongoing relationship between Scotland and England, or Scotland and the rest of the United Kingdom, and responsibility for constitutional matters. And it was quite clear, because it was debated in Parliament at the time, that responsibility for constitutional matters should lie with Westminster. Now, that was what was in the Scotland Act, and that was what people voted for in the referendum. Okay. And therefore, it's quite clear that moral authority on this matter does lie with Westminster.
Karen Kenyon-Wright, who obviously chaired the Scottish Constitutional Convention, he is writing tonight that if the Union's unwritten constitutional claim to have the last word is so inflexible that it proves incapable of recognising Scotland's constitutional claim, then they're in effect saying that the only way in which Scotland's people can be sovereign is by independence. And that is the logic of your position.
No, that's not actually. No, that's not the logic of my position at all, I'm afraid. My position and the committee's position is that we want to see an agreement between Westminster and Holyrood on how the referendum should go forward, because we believe that it's in Scotland's interest to have this resolved as quickly as possible. We want to have all the issues hopefully debated and agreed between the two parliaments, but if it's not possible to get an agreement, then ultimately responsibility does lie with Westminster. And we are worried that those who fear defeat in the referendum will try and spin this out either by taking it through a process that will result in legal action or by delaying through a number of other mechanisms.
You do, and we have to leave it there. Thank you very much indeed.